everybody. I'm Tabitha, and today we're going to do some book reviews. If you're a regular watcher of this channel, you might be wondering why I'm doing a review video a week into October. The fast answer is I've already read 5 books this week. That means if I wait till the end of the month, this is going to be a massively long video. So I'm going to bring you the 5 books I've already read in October, and we'll see how the rest of the month goes. A couple of disclaimers before we start. First, there are timestamps in the comments, so you can see the titles of the books that I'm bringing you reviews for, and helpful timestamps that will let you jump to that book if you're searching for something specific. Also, these reviews are obviously my opinion. I don't expect you to have the same opinion as me. In fact, if you've read one of these books, I want to know your opinion. Drop your opinion down in the comments so that I can see what you thought of these books. Second, and if you're a watcher of this channel, you probably already know this, I read a little bit of everything. Pay attention to the Who Should Read This section, where I'll help you find something that might fit your specific tastes. Lastly, if you have recommendations of something I might love based on something you see here, drop a comment and let me know the title of the book and the author's name, and I can see about adding it to my TBR. If you're recommending something that you had a part in bringing to life, either as an author or as a publisher, or maybe even as an audiobook narrator, instead of dropping a comment down below, you can follow the link in the description where you can send me information about that book. It might help you jump up in the TBR if I agree to review it for you. Without further ado, let's get to the 5 books that I've already finished in October. The first book I finished in the month of October is Suicide Notes from Beautiful Girls by Lynn Weingarten. This is a young adult contemporary book, although it does certainly have mystery elements to it. It's a 2015 release by Simon Pulse, and it is 320 pages. Your synopsis. They say Delia committed suicide, but June doesn't believe it, and she owes it to her friend to uncover the truth. Let's start with what I didn't like so I can get to what I did like. First, this book contains a lot of sensitive topics. Now, actually, this didn't really bother me, but this seemed like a good place for me to insert a warning for those of you who may be triggered by some of these more sensitive topics. This book is going to tackle things like sexual tension and even rape, alcohol and drug use in teenagers, even murder, and of course suicide are discussed in this book. Just be ready for that. The second thing I can say that some people might not like is unanswered questions. Again, in the case of this book, this didn't bother me. I don't have a problem with books leaving unanswered questions at the end. However, if you are the kind of person who is bothered by not having all the answers on that last page, be aware of that for this book. You're not getting all of your answers. Let's get to what I did like, or in this case, absolutely loved. The first thing I loved about this book is the ending. Now, this is not a popular opinion. I've been looking at Goodreads and a lot of people absolutely hate this ending. So it's definitely a love-hate kind of situation. I personally loved it. I love when a book messes with my preconceived notions about where the plot is going to go or what twists are going to happen or how everything is going to be tied up. I love when I finish a book and it leaves me thinking or wondering or questioning. I love that. And this ending, it did all of that and more. It will resonate with me for a long time. If you're looking for a quick lesson for yourself as a writer on how to leave a book hanging and leave unanswered questions, this book I'm going to recommend for you because this ending did all of that. The second thing I loved about this book is the descriptions and the language in this one are absolutely beautiful. The imagery in this book is amazing. Weingarten weaves complex, beautiful descriptions into everything from scenery to hard to explain, difficult, complex emotions, and I just loved all of it. This language was a masterclass study in how to describe things. The third thing I loved about this book is morally questionable characters. If you watch these reviews at all, you know that I love a morally questionable character. This book is loaded with them. It results in you, the reader, not knowing which character you can trust, which is great for the mystery elements of this book. So who do I think should read this one? If you like dark books where the plot is going to twist and turn and get you lost and tangled in it, you will absolutely love this book. My rating, well, if you hadn't already figured it out by the fact that I really didn't have anything negative for me to say, I'm gonna give this one 5 stars. I absolutely love this book and it goes down as a new favorite for me for sure. If you can handle dark books, you do not want to miss this one. So 5 stars for Suicide Notes from Beautiful Girls. The second book that I finished in the month of October is Teardrop by Lauren Kate. This is a young adult fantasy published in 2013 by Delacorte Books for Young Readers. This one is 441 pages. Your synopsis. After Eureka's mother is killed in an accident, Eureka wants to escape her life. When her mother leaves her a strange inheritance that a mysterious boy seems to know too much about, Eureka will be forced to confront her family's secrets. So let's start with what I didn't like about this one. First, the pace. The pacing of this book was off. It felt a little too slow for me. In fact, it felt like this entire book was almost a prequel setting us up for what I hope is more action coming in book two. 441 pages, in my opinion, is too long for a book that's just going to be a prequel or a lead-up book. I felt like I spent a lot of this book just waiting for something to happen. The second thing I wasn't crazy about for this book, and if you watch this channel, you know this bugs me a lot, is that this book was a little too predictable for me. I like twists that I don't see coming. I like characters that do things I don't expect, and this book just didn't deliver on that. The third thing that fell flat for me in this one, and this is unusual for Lauren Kate, I've liked some of her other books for the exact opposite reason of this, so this one was really disappointing from her, and that's that the characters were not great. I didn't love them. Typically, when I read a Lauren Kate book, I really fall in love with some of the characters enough that it keeps me going through the series. Sometimes I fall in love with many of them. In this book, there just were none that I could connect with, and all of them felt kind of forgettable. So what did I like about this book? Well, the first thing I liked about this book is the actual idea itself had a lot of promise, and some of how it played out worked really well for me. So the idea or the concept behind this one is that someone's tears actually have power, and to me that's pretty cool. The second thing I like about this book is the epilogue. And I don't always love epilogues, but this one really worked. Part of the reason why I think it might work is because this is the only chapter we get from Brooke's point of view. And I think that just is proof to me that I wanted more of him, that maybe if he got to narrate more of these chapters or maybe this book, I might have loved it more. I might have even liked Brooke as a character more. So that's positive towards possibly reading book two. So I won't immediately take book two off my wish list because I think there's a possibility that Brooks could come into play more in book two, and that interests me. So who should read this one? If you like your YA fantasy to lead with romance and sideline the action, I think you'll like this one. There is romance in this one, and I feel like the romance could work for someone, but it feels like the action took a sideline. So if you like your romance to lead, then I think you might enjoy this one. The second kind of reader I think might enjoy this one is those of you who just love triangles, but you want something a little different. So you like the idea of a love triangle, but you want to play with it a little. You want it to have twists. You don't want it to seem so obvious. You might enjoy this one. My overall rating, I went 2 stars for this one. I like twists, and I like action, and I feel like I wanted more of those from this book than I got. So overall, 2 stars for Teardrop by Lauren Kate. Third book I finished for the month of October is this one, Fur Lodge by Sean McMahon. This is an adult science fiction novel published in 2018. Sean independently publishes, so this one comes from Amazon, and it is 559 pages. Your synopsis. Trapped in a 33-hour time loop, Hal and Kara must restart their past and find a sequence that will change their fate. I always like to start with what I didn't like so that I can lead you on a positive note. So what didn't I like about this one? First, the dialogue sounds a little immature in some parts. So some of the dialogue almost seems like what you'd expect in a young adult, but this is a novel written for adults. So sometimes that was a little off-putting, but as a young adult reader myself, I don't think it bothered me as much as it might bother people who don't read YA. The second thing I didn't particularly like about this one is the timeline is questionable and sometimes can be hard to follow. Specifically, the 165th restart, and I feel like I'm not spoiling by telling you that 165th is coming because it happens to be the opening chapter. It actually required me to reread a few of the chapters, and honestly, I'm not entirely sure I could tell you the order of the events that happened in that 165th restart, which seems like a problem because I think that was supposed to be a really important one. But the timeline just seemed a little off, and that probably is because we're playing around with time travel, and honestly, it could just be me. I don't know. The third and final thing I wasn't crazy about for this book is the pacing. There were some sections in here that felt like they dragged and were a little too long, leading to pages and sections that I kind of felt like I could have skipped or ditched altogether without losing anything. So what did I like about this book? Well, the first thing that I loved loved about this particular book is that the entire concept about getting stuck in a time loop, of course it's been done before, but this book brings an interesting viewpoint and some really cool science fiction sort of twists to it that I feel like really worked. It kicked that story of being stuck in a time loop up a notch, and I really, really appreciated that. The second and final thing I liked about this one is the ending. This final chapter really kicked this novel up a notch. It needed that final chapter exactly as written. I almost can say that I gave it an extra star just because of that final ending. That final ending was great. That gives me hope for the second book in the series that we might be exploring more of how that final chapter went, and that to me is very exciting. So who do I think should read this one? If you are a science fiction fan and you enjoy the idea of a time loop, I think you'll like how this one plays out and is one that I would recommend highly. My rating? Overall, I went 3 stars for this one. There were some parts that dragged, but overall it was an interesting story with a satisfying conclusion, and I will be looking for the second one. 3 stars for Fur Lodge by Sean McMahon. The fourth book I finished for the month of October is Confessions of a Bad Ugly Singer by Collette McLafferty. It's a 2018 publication by New Haven Publishing, 227 pages, and it is an adult nonfiction story. Your synopsis. After one gig with a pink cover band, Collette was sued for $10 million. This is her story. So what didn't I like about this one? The first thing I wasn't crazy about is the name dropping. I'm not a huge celebrity fan, so when people name drop celebrities, it doesn't get my attention. It does the opposite and actually bores me or turns me off of the story just a little bit. I was able to ignore it once I glossed over the names. The second thing I wasn't crazy about in this one is that it is a little repetitive. And honestly, I feel like sometimes it serves a purpose, but it does repeat things in the middle. The third and final thing I wasn't crazy about for this one is the figurative language. The figurative language was well written, but I'll come back to that. What I didn't like about the figurative language here is that it was all related to pop culture. And since I'm not a huge pop culture fan or celebrity junkie, this didn't really work for me. I feel like it would work really well for another reader or another type of audience, and I'm just not that pop culture junkie that would appreciate all of those. So what did I like about this one? The first thing I liked about this one is that the legal system inside look of this book was really well written. I would say this book is an excellent book for somebody who is studying the legal system or who wants to read about the downside of our culture's problem with excessive litigation. This book would be a great case study for that. Honestly, I didn't know what to expect going into this book, and I definitely didn't expect to have that kind of level of look at the legal system, and I was really intrigued by that. That gave this book an extra star up for sure. The second thing I liked about this one is Collette takes a really hard look at the mental struggle surrounding these accusations. And I thought that was really well written. This is where the repetitive sections, I think, can sometimes come into play and work. Oftentimes when we're accused of something, we can't help but replay those accusations over and over again, almost like a loop in our mind. And Collette uses that as a tool. So sometimes that really works to highlight how her mental state was. And that's a case of where that repetitive nature sometimes worked in her favor. It makes you feel what she felt in regards to those nasty claims. And that worked. It really gave us a picture of the mental issues that Collette was going through. The third and final thing that I liked about this one, and I have to say, I wasn't sure what to expect when I read the blurb for this one, but this book was well written. I alluded to this in that when I said the figurative language was good. So let's talk about that a little bit. The language here in this book is actually really pretty. The descriptions work. The writing is honest. It's well done. The figurative language is there to help us feel and relate to things that we would normally have a little trouble relating to, because there are definitely situations Collette's in that most of us have never been in. The figurative language helps with that. So overall, I thought this was really well written. So who do I think should read this one? If, unlike me, you actually have heard of this story, of the pink cover band case, then I think you're going to love the inside look to this case. I didn't know anything about it going in, but I think if you did, this would be a great way for you to see what that was like from the inside. The other people who I think should read this one are people who are interested in nonfiction books about the costs or the consequences of litigation. This is, again, an inside story I think you're really going to enjoy. The final people who I think would really enjoy this one are honestly people, unlike me, who maybe are big music industry fans. Maybe you would love the inside look at what it's like for a musician on the inside. This book is going to be right up your alley. It's well written and it's a good nonfiction book for that. Overall, my rating for this one, 3.5 stars, but on Goodreads, I rounded up to 4. I enjoyed the voice and the writing for this one, even though I'm not a huge celebrity or music insider fan. But I think some of you who are huge Celebrity or Music Insider fans, this would definitely be higher up, closer to 5 stars for you. So for me, 3.5 stars for Confessions of a Bad Ugly Singer by Collette McLafferty. All right, the fifth book that I've already finished for the month of October is Heartless by Marissa Meyer. This is a 2016 publication by Fellow and Friends. It is 453 pages, and it's a young adult fantasy story. Your synopsis: before the Queen of Hearts was the terror of Wonderland, she was just a girl who wanted to fall in love. So what didn't I like about this story? Well, for this one, there's really only one thing that I wasn't crazy about, and that's in that the biggest twist of the story wasn't a huge surprise to me. It didn't really ruin anything, and there was plenty of other stuff to enjoy, but you know it bugs me a little sometimes when a few things are predictable. There are also two things in this book that certain readers might not like. One of those is, if you are not a huge fan of baking or cooking, I can see some of those sections where our main character is baking or cooking getting a little dull, boring, or too long. The other thing is, I could say, if you're not into silly fantasy, like in the style of Alice in Wonderland, obviously the Wonderland style silliness might bother you a little. But then again, if you're not a huge fan of Alice in Wonderland, I don't know why you would pick up this book. So what did I like? No. What did I love about this story? The first is that the characters were amazing, and I knew they would be because the characters in Alice in Wonderland really work for me. This book takes place before Alice in Wonderland, and it's kind of a fairy tale retelling of how the backstory could have gone. And so a lot of our characters are themselves, but they're growing into the character we know and love. And of course, I absolutely loved all of that. My absolute favorite, if you made me pick, would definitely be Hatter, but that's not a huge surprise because he's my favorite in all of the retelling versions of Alice in Wonderland. The second thing I loved about this one is the justifiable descent into madness that Catherine, the Queen of Hearts, goes through. It's well-written. It's absolutely wonderful, totally justifiable, and I absolutely adored watching this happening. I loved watching her anger and her snark developing, and I have to be honest, I literally cheered, threw my hands up in the air the first time Off With Their Head came out. Awesome. The third thing that I loved about this one is there were huge parallels, more than I was expecting, between the Queen's origin story and the story we know for Alice. And I loved that. It gave a whole new depth to the story of Alice in Wonderland that I wasn't expecting. I was expecting this book to be great on its own and to match up with that one, and of course I got that. But in addition to that, I saw huge parallels between who the Queen is and what she goes through and Alice herself. And I think that might even make Alice in Wonderland better for me, because you read Alice in Wonderland for the first time and you wonder why in the world this queen seems to hate Alice so much right from the start. And I think this almost gives us the idea that maybe she saw too much of herself and what she went through in Alice. In other words, it was too painful of a reminder. And that is really, really cool and something I wasn't expecting. So who should read this one? If you are an Alice in Wonderland fan and you have not already read this, I'm gonna suggest you add it to your TBR, because this journey that gets us back to Wonderland, that brings our favorite characters up to where they may have started in Alice, is wonderful, and I highly recommend that. I'm also gonna say, if you're just a fantasy fan in general and you like your fantasy to have silly elements like Wonderland might have, I think you would enjoy this one, even if you weren't necessarily an Alice in Wonderland fan. My overall rating, I went 4 stars on this one, and the only reason I couldn't give it 5 is because I do think this has a slightly more niche audience. I don't think everyone is going to love it, and that, of course, that twist was a little more predictable than I wanted, but I absolutely fell in love with this story, and I would recommend it to all the people who fit the who would I suggest read this section. So 4 stars for Heartless by Marissa Meyer. Okay, that's it for me and the 5 books that I read in this first week of October. I don't know if I'll be back next week with reviews, but I know I'll be back next week. So definitely make sure you hit subscribe so you know when I'm back. Keep plotting the path to your dreams, and I will see you next time. Bye.